Let me start with this phrase first. Without a doubt, football possesses various values that can be utilized for good. So not only football is a competitive cultural content that assists to attain societal values, but it's also an effective mechanism for education. My name is Alex Gang. I'm currently working for Seongnam Football Club in Korea. I received my MPA degree in 2015, and since then, I'm working as the assistant manager for the number one club in Asia, I wish. It's going to come. Yeah, in a few years. Yeah. So my intention is here to scrutinize the current niche of football in Korean society in order to ultimately to pose an idea to actualize the values inherent in football. The topic of today's presentation, as shown above, is utilizing the concept of CSR, corporate social responsibility, to increase participation of youth in football. All right. The presentation will follow that sequence, in which I will first explain how football is perceived in Korean society in general. Then I will move to depict the Korean Professional Football League. That is the highest football league played in South Korea. And then I would love to broach the topic of today, younger generations, and find a niche in the field of football currently, and how they are participating and in what form. And next, how this concept of social corporate social responsibility is being used to entice public involvement in Korea. And lastly, I will suggest an idea that equips visions to imbue the value of football to the children in the future. All right, football in Korea, I would love to mention, and I cannot ignore the fact that we have hosted 2002 World Cup in Korea, in Japan. So, I think I'm pretty sure that everybody here in this room has a vivid image of 2002 World Cup. The Korean men's national team not only obtained unexpected tournament results at the end of the World Cup, but also it was an opportunity to perceive football as an effective social mechanism. In a broader sense, this international tournament paved the way for football to be considered as a tool to attain social integration. At the same time, it provided a venue for Korean public to experience a sense of unity, regardless of their backgrounds, social standings, etc., which led to a rise of cultural phenomena such as street cheering, mass public gathering for Korean men's national team's match. So the expectation that football can become a powerful cultural content with broader influence on society based on the popularity resourced by Korean public during the World Cup has gained its prominence aftermath of Korean World Cup in 2002. And I think there are various indicators that accurately epitomize Korean football nowadays, but I would mention that Korean football is currently ranked number one in Asia, according to the Asian Football Confederation, which is a sum of cumulative ranking of men's national team's performance and domestic league. But flipping the coin to the other side, I would love to raise a point about the number of direct participants that have been measured in 2015. So according to Korean Football Association, only 30,581 people are registered as the registered football player in Korea, which comprises only about 0.06% of total population. If I have to compare this this number with other countries such as Germany and Japan, this is a pretty low, and it's a bit discouraging, I would say. So, what this says is while Korea successfully retained its prominence and competitiveness on the pitch, the base that buttresses the system remains pretty narrow, and elitism is still the driving force that sustains Korean football So we are operating with a limited base, and we have to rely on their performance to obtain competitive results at the international venue. So let me move on to Korean Professional Football League, which is known as K-League. It was established in 1983. I mean, it started with two teams at the beginning, but the number of the teams has been experiencing a sustainable increase and reached 24 last year. So we are operating two divisions in which 12 teams are playing in the first division, whereas the remaining 12 teams are in the second division. And, you know, the rate of seat occupancy in the season of 2014, I mean, this captures importance because that's directly related to the survival of the teams like us. So if you see the number, it's about 25.8% on average that K-League matches have been filled with spectators. So only a quarter of the stadium were filled with the fans, and while the rest, three-quarter, have been emptied without any spectators. I mean, this, and if I have to compare once again with other competitive sports in Korea, baseball, basketball, volleyball, the figure is also discouraging, and it shows how, how much distance we have to cover to transform as a competitive sport in Korea. So, I mean, issues will be arising because, I mean, you know, the rate of seat occupancy is closely related to our revenue, source of revenue, which leads to our fiscal self-reliance. And also, it is an effective measure to know about the level of integration of our team in the local society, whether our identity is able to intermingle that of the local and regional community. So we have been, we were a host of international tournament in 2002, what happened afterwards was a bit discouraging and counterproductive, and it defines where you are at now. So if you look at the figure, it describes about the average number of spectators, and it directly compares the spectators that are amassed in K-League matches, as shown in blue, and A matches, which means international matches performed by a Korean national team. So what you will see is, I mean, there is a gap. Of course, I mean, there are shortcomings that I make, direct comparison between two of these events because there are only 10 at maximum A matches taking place a year in Korea, whereas each professional team hosts about 18 home games in Korea. So, I mean, in terms of frequency and also the days for promotion, it really diverges between the two spectrum, I would say. Those that's why I mean, the numbers in parentheses is the rate of seat occupancy. I mean, you will see that the number is, it does not exceed 30 or 35%. I mean, the maximum rate was about 34%, I believe. So in 2015, we were able to generate some helpful data in which we scrutinized the spectators based on the age groups. So, I mean, as you will see, I'm not quite sure if you can see, but there is a age group delineation that which pinpoints the fact about 76% of all spectators were in the age group, between the age group 21 and 40, whereas the teenagers below 20 were only 11% of the entire spectators who visited the stadia in Korea for K-League matches. So, I mean, there's a need to conduct an in-depth study on the 11% in tiny section of the spectators. So, what the pie table suggests is that the frequency of visit per season of the 11% teenagers So 91.7% they were one-time visitors, whereas only 8% were visited the stadium two times or more. Which means, I mean, that's a result that, you know, of a rule that Korean Football Association granted. So, I mean, we, for the first time, if teenagers visit the stadium of K-League, they will get hours for their volunteer work, which they need for school, for their academic career. So I mean, this figure also shows a kind of gloomy picture of Korean football. So, you know, based on the figures and numbers we have examined just before, we can reach a conclusion that, you know, football and the culture that underpins it has not been effectively ingrained in local culture in Korea. Because, I mean, we obviously see a limited number of people are participating directly or indirectly in professional football. And also, disparities exist between the national and regional / local level, whereas the national team A matches are enjoying their popularity. The local level, which can be depicted by Korean professional teams, their matches still struggle of deficiency of spectators who come to enjoy the game. So, I mean, and also very important fact is that, you know, it has been shunned by the younger generations as a competitive cultural content, because, I mean, you know, teenagers are, you know, showing their limited, I mean, almost inactive participation in football industry in general. So, and also values that are inherent in football, I mean, in a broader sense, it can function as an effective mechanism for social integration. And in a smaller sense, as I mentioned, it is an underpinning source for determining local identity. Those two values are remaining as unfulfilled as well. So it's worth to examine the current promotion strategies of the Korean professional teams and what they do to entice younger generations below the age of 20. Well, if you will see later in this presentation, there is a certain obscurity in definition, what kind of strategy they use. So the distinction between promotion and CSR becomes kind of blurred. If you look at the specific details about the strategies, because, I mean, all of them kind of embody philanthropic ways of reaching out to the community, but also it possesses possesses perspectives of promotion, like it's transmitting messages to the recipients and all that. So, I mean, if I have to mention about corporate social responsibility in general, I believe it reflects changing public perception on the role of organizations, including our organizations, such as Seongnam Football Club and other professional teams. So people are asserting on the necessity of having the obligation to render services and capital to society. And that's where we can draw a close relationship between CSR and professional football, because as an elite entity in football that prides itself, you know, in elitism in football, it is our obligation to share the expertise we have on football. So in terms of like providing educational hours and also hosting football tournaments that could help to promote football in general. So, I mean, that's how, that's a brief description of how CSR is conducted. You have to have initiatives, plus, I mean, you have to have an underpinning motivation to conduct such an activity. And what you aim to attain is basically two objectives. One being enhanced image or reputation of your organization. And second, it gets more specific because it tackles work-related capacities such as productivity, and also revenue generation and other related work-related capacities. So that's the way how CSR works. But what I have done is I have examined all CSR activities that are currently conducted by 24 professional teams in Korea. So you can classify their work into four different classifications: volunteer work, donation, community outreach, and football education. And that's the teams are currently being active in terms of CSR activities and to promote football in general. But I mean, it's very, very important to point out that those four classifications, those four driving motives for conducting CSR, surely helped us to enhance our image and reputation in our society. But on the other hand, there has been a reason for conducting CSR, which is justification for existence. I mean, what I mean by this is, in 2015, none of the 24 professional teams in Korea was self-reliant in terms of fiscal management. So they are relying on some entities. In our case, we are relying on City of Seongnam to provide our revenues, to provide our income. So CSIO has been a good excuse for the professional teams to provide the justification for existence, which are closely related to survival. So the CSR activities have been lacking, designed strategies, and also it has been conducted kind of superficially without a true motives and what it wishes to do with CSR. So, and based on this, we have been conducting an initiative in which we would love to tackle two underpinning questions about football and attaining its value. First, the first question was how to design our CSR initiatives to boost both direct participation of the youth, meaning increasing the number of teenagers who will be registered as a legal players, and second, indirect participation amongst the youth, meaning they could enjoy the beauty of football by coming to the stadium. So in that way, they're becoming kind of an indirect consumer of football. And second question was to develop a mechanism that fulfills the value of football. So, as I said, as a professional football team in Korea, it has obligation to attain and transmit the messages of values of football. So that's why we have taken this into our consideration. And as a result, we call it Seongnam Football Education Program, which came into birth in a cooperation with local Ministry of Education. So the program is based on two main pillars. One is stadium tour, and second is football clinic. I mean, it's not something special, but the unique aspect of about our program is it's implemented as curricular activities, which will be almost mandatory for every elementary school children. So in 2015, you have done it, we had a capacity of hosting about 100 sessions, but which have been filled like immediately. So reflecting their needs, so we have increased it, the number of overall sections. But that's why, so idea has been given that, we have to make it mandatory for every school children wants to visit the stadium and to be the recipient of football clinic. Well, I would love to go into the details about those two programs, but I do not necessarily have the time. So I think, to sum up, what we want to attain as a professional football team is to increase the exposure of children to football in order to, for them to realize what is the, driving force what that society can attain, like through football. So we wish to increase the base and boost their participation. But one concern remains unanswered, that is utilizing political dynamics. I mean, this program is not the product of my idea. Rather, I mean, it involved active participation of the people in the decision making positions. So, I mean, Korean society generally possesses a negative connotation of intermingling politics with sports. But, I mean, that's the future area we have to pay close attention to. So, to sum up, I would raise a point that, I became cognizant that myriad countries across the globe, including Hungary, Korea, realize the importance of sports and identify it as a national strategic agenda. But as we learned from our own experience, it cannot only be the amount of investment you make, or it cannot be the international tournaments, the amount of international tournaments you will host, but it is rather about how you perceive the values of football and the way you transmit the message to the generations to come. Thank you.